All right, are we ready to continue our study of the Word of God? Excellent. So let's pray. Let's bow our heads and let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, our Judge, our Creator, our Savior, our personal friend, we come to you, we want to praise your name for your goodness toward us, and we want to thank you that we can know that good news, that you are for us and never against us. And now when we are reflecting on the meaning of God's judgment, what does it mean that you are our judge? Please create a pure heart within us. Purify us from all our iniquities and our sins, and fill us with your Holy Spirit, and give us wisdom from above, that we can see and understand your word better, that we can live it better and proclaim it in such a way that we will bring hope to others, that your name can be glorified. So bless us also in now in our discussion and in studying your word, and we thank you for your presence and guidance in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Well, the title of the second presentation is, Are the Last Days Really Here? And I think that the obvious answer is for all of us, yes, we are living in the last days. But let me go into that topic and be more precise in our understanding of the last days. I would like to introduce it by another question. And this question is very important. How to put together the biblical teaching about God's judgment and the gospel? I already told you that the three-angel message is the gospel. You know, sometimes people are asking the question, well, Pastor, tell me, Dr. Moskala, tell me, what do we need to preach? Three-angel message or the gospel? What is the answer? That there is no dichotomy, right, between that two. What to preach, three-angel message or the gospel? Three-angel message is the gospel. And if we are not preaching three-angel message as the gospel, then we need to learn again and unlearn what we are doing and learn what is right, because three-angel message is the gospel. It's eternal gospel. We are not preaching something new. It's always valid gospel, eternal gospel. And this is what we are bringing. So now, the question is, how to put these two ideas together? If I would stop here and you know only from my presentation what I did in the first hour, you already have some partial answer, because we had these biblical definitions, very clear definition, what is the primary meaning of God's judgment. But now let's go deeper into it. And all my three presentations, which will now follow, will go together with that question, how to put this judgment in such a way that gospel will be there. It means that Jesus will be really at the center. So let's go on the journey. How is divine eschatological judgment usually presented in our theology or in our presentations, in our preaching? Well, when you speak about God's judgment, how do you present it? When you read it in the textbooks and even with the solid textbooks, how is it presented? Well, it is usually explained in three phases. Am I correct? Where do you start when you speak about God's eschatological judgment? About this God's universal judgment, you speak about God's universal judgment and say, well, in this eschatological judgment of God, it starts when? It starts in 1844. Okay, this is what we stay. And we speak about the first phase of God's eschatological judgment, and this is pre-Advent judgment. And we start with the year 1844. Then we go to judgment during millennium, This is after the second coming of Jesus, which will be, judgment in heaven, where all saints will participate in it. And then we conclude that there will be the final judgment or last judgment at the end of millennium, which will be the total destruction and destroying of Satan and evil angels and sinners, and all sin and death will be no more in the whole universe. So this is what we usually say. Am I right? So when we speak about God judgment, we start with 1844, we go to the pre-advent judgment, what's going on right now, then we go to the millennium, and then to the last judgment. Well, this is what we are doing. Is it what the Bible presents to us? Yes, this is biblical teaching. I don't want to say that what we say about pre-advent judgment, judgment during millennium and the final judgment is not biblical. But what I would like to say is to ask the question, is this understanding in harmony with all biblical teaching, with all biblical data? And now I have to be with you a little bit more technical, and I hope that you are still very well alive, that you can pay attention to each word, because this will be now sometimes more difficult. So I want that you catch the main point. So let me tell you very clearly that this recognition that there are three eschatological judgments, pre-advent judgment, judgment during millennium, and then the last judgment, this recognition is right, it's correct, as for the events. Okay? Events. These three events are eschatological events. This is part of the eschatological judgment. And also the date, like 1844, is correct, it's biblical. And I can, if I would have a class of Daniel, I can show it to you and prove it to you. I will be the first one who will defend the date 1844. But even though it is a very solid biblical teaching, this recognition is wrong from another point. From what? It's wrong for the starting point of the eschatological judgment. Why? Because in the year 1844, what started? Thus, in 1844 started God's eschatological judgment or pre-advent judgment? And I will argue and I will try to show it to you that in 1844 did not start God's eschatological judgment. It was already in continuation. What started was the pre-advent judgment in 1844. So, yes, there are these three eschatological judgment. The year 1844 is correct for the pre-advent judgment, but as for the big picture, the starting point of God's eschatological judgment, not pre-advent judgment, but eschatological judgment, it's not in 1844. So let me explain now. There is a difference between the eschatological judgment and the pre-advent judgment. Please give this in mind. The pre-advent judgment is part of the eschatological judgment, but pre-advent judgment is not equal with the eschatological judgment or end-time judgment. The starting point for the pre-advent judgment is 1844. I already stated that, but I stress it that will be no confusion here. But now, the big question is, and pay attention now to that question, when does start the eschatological judgment, the end time judgment? Where is the starting point? Let me ask a different question. Are the last days really here, already here? Are the last days already here? And the answer is, certainly, we strongly believe that we are living in the last days. And this is biblical, that we are here. But now the question is, when do the last days begin? When the last days begin? When the end of the ages begin? When does the end of the ages start it? What is the answer? You give me now the answer. When does the end of ages begin? When do the last days begin? When? And I am sure that now you are thinking, well, what are you asking, Pastor, about? What is our usual answer to that question? When does the last days begin? What do we say? Well, you are Seventh-day Adventist, right? And what we answer, usually without thinking, we answer, well, this last day started in 1798 with the end of French Revolution, or if you want to be more precise, with 1844. 1798 or 1844, you know, at the time after the French Revolution, when the new era is actually here, the last days started. Is this answer right or wrong? And I would like now to hear from you. Is it right or wrong? Right or wrong? You are very careful in your answers. you see that something must be behind here. And I would like to give very clear answer to that question. I repeat once again, I will go back. When do the last days begin? In 1844? Or in 1798? And the answer is that this is completely wrong answer. Why it is wrong? Because the Bible is telling us something different. And for me, it's not what we are saying, but what the Bible says. This is the most important. Amen? If you don't prove it something from the Bible to me, I will never accept that. But if you will come and show me the biblical reasoning, biblical teaching, biblical theology, that it is pointing to the direction, I will be the first one who will accept that. So now let me prove it from the Bible. Our faith must be always built on it is written, correct? So the question is now, what is written? So let me now go to the beginning of the eschatological judgment. And let me show it to you, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. Paul is saying, in the past God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways, but in these last days he has spoken to us by whom? By Prophet Daniel? No, by Jesus Christ, by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things and through whom he made the universe. So when did the last days began, according to that text, from 1844? No, it came from the first coming of Jesus. The last days are here because Jesus came for the first time. So in a simple way, it will be like from the incarnation, from the time when Jesus was here. All right, let me go to Acts chapter 2, verse 17. Now Peter is preaching and says, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy, your young men will see visions, your old men will dream dreams. So what is the time? From when are the last days? He says, Peter says, this is now the fulfillment. Fulfillment of what was Joel saying, and the fulfillment is that in the last days, the Spirit of God will come. And the Spirit of God came on the Pentecost, right? You know the story. And he says, yes. And this is the sign that the last days are already here. So when the last days started? From incarnation of Jesus. And when Peter was preaching and the Pentecost, the last days were already there, were already present. Let me give you another text, Hebrews 9:26, and I will go only to the last part. But now, he has appeared. Who appeared? Jesus Christ. He has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to do what? To do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. So we are talking about the cross of Jesus, about the death of Jesus. So now the author of Hebrews, Paul, as I believe, is very precise and is saying that the end of the ages arrived from when? From 1844? No, it arrived from the cross of Jesus. From the time when Jesus died. This is actually, you know, the time of the appearance when the end of the ages came down to us, and when Jesus Christ died for us on the cross for our sins. He sacrificed himself for us. Well, I can continue with many other texts. You can see also on the screen. This is, 1 Corinthians 10:11, 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1 Timothy, and so forth. So the question is very clear, last days, the end of the ages. We discover that it is from the first coming of Jesus. When Jesus arrived here 2,000 years ago, the last days appeared. The end of the ages was here. Eschatological time started with him. All right, so now let me give you another question, and let me be now very technical, okay? This will be a very technical study on the vocabulary of the Bible. And the question is there a difference between the last days and the time of the end? Is there a difference in the Bible between the last days and the time of the end? I know that we, in our vocabulary today, we are using it as a synonyms, okay? We can say the last days or the time of the end, and we think about the same thing, okay? But now, is there a difference in the Bible between the last days and the time of the end? As you can see, I am showing that the phrase, the time of the end, which in Hebrew is etketz, the time and the end, the time of the end, okay, etketz, is a specific exegetical idiomatic expression. It's a very unique expression used only by Daniel in the book of Daniel. And this expression, the time of the end, is referring to 1798, or French Revolution, and events after the French Revolution, or if we want to be more precise, to 1844. And as you can see, this phrase, etketz, the time of the end, is used 5 times in the Bible, and only in the book of Daniel. Daniel 8:17, 11:35, 11:40, 12:4, and 12:9. It's a specific idiomatic expression which is there, referring to the time of the end from the French Revolution on, from the 1798, from 1844 going forward. And this is a very important observation. So, in other words, we need to make a difference between general eschatological time, which was inaugurated when? At the first coming of Jesus. General eschatological time, okay? Inaugurated at the first coming of Jesus. The last days, the end of the ages, the end time arrived with Jesus. Because this is the most important event. Jesus is his first coming. This is the crucial point in the not only history of our planet Earth, but in the story of the whole universe. The incarnation, the life of Jesus, his death and his resurrection. And he was born in order to die. And he was resurrected because he died victoriously. Therefore, the cross of Jesus is the focal point. So yes, general eschatological time, if I would simplify it, starts from the cross of Jesus. But then there is a specific prophetic eschatological time. Prophetic or apocalyptic eschatological time. The time of the end. This is this technical terminology, time of the end. And this has Daniel and then the book of Revelation in view when it is explained in Daniel chapter 7 to 9 and also chapter 12, when the 1798 and 1844 marks the beginning of this time of the end. So if I repeat it once again, that everybody can grasp it, and this is very important. These two times, general eschatological time and the specific eschatological time, prophetic eschatological time, are not in contradiction. They are complementary. The last days, the end of the ages, started from the time of the cross, first coming of Jesus. But the time of the end, this prophetic eschatological time, according to the book of Daniel, started from 1798 or 1844. Maybe you are visual, so I would like to give you now the visual picture which can help you to grasp what we are talking about, what the Bible is presenting. Here you have the first coming of Jesus with the cross at the center, and you have the second coming of Jesus, okay? He's coming down for us. So now you have that time period between the first coming and second coming of Jesus. In the Bible, this cross of Jesus, the coming of Jesus, inaugurated the eschatological time. And this is what I am calling here the last days or general eschatological time. Cross, this is the main point. And from the cross, you have these last days here. The end time, and then this is measuring the whole time from the first to the second coming of Christ. But then you have the year of 1798 or 1844, and this period of time, and only this, is now this specific eschatological time. This was general, but now it's specific, and this is now focusing on these last days, more precisely, and these last days before the second coming of Christ are this prophetical eschatological time. It's apocalyptic time, the time of the end as we have it. So you see, it's a complementary. You know, this one part belongs under the big umbrella. And this is what we need to understand. So you see, when we speak about eschatology, where we have to start? With 1844? No, never, please never do that. Don't make this mistake, okay? Eschatological time started with the cross of Jesus, with Jesus Christ. And this is the central point here, that the cross is inaugurating eschatology. The cross is inaugurating the last days. The cross is inaugurating the end of the ages. So you can see that the main point is the cross of Jesus. The cross is the central point of biblical teaching about eschatology. And we can see, eschatological time, and I repeat once again, that will be very clear, the time of the end, the end time, the last days arrived with the cross of Jesus, with the first coming of Jesus. So, Where does the problem lie? When we were talking about this understanding of the eschatology. We have the correct biblical teaching about pre-advent judgment and very correct teaching about 1844, but the event of 1844 is very often isolated from the most crucial point. And what is the most crucial point? The cross of our Savior Jesus Christ. Because the most important point is not the date, not the event, but the person. It's Jesus Christ. And he must be always at the center of everything. And now I will be very emphatic, because this is so important to understand. You know, the central place in the history of the whole universe is the cross of Jesus. The central place of the plan of salvation is the cross of Jesus. The central point of all eschatological teaching of our church and biblical teaching is the cross of Jesus. The cross of Christ, Jesus himself, must be the starting point of all our discourses of the divine judgment. Amen? Cross of Jesus, Jesus himself, the year 31 AD, and not 1844, has to be the foundational and beginning reference point of God's eschatological judgment. I repeat once again, when you speak about God's eschatological judgment, you cannot start in 1844. You always have to start with the most important point, and this is the cross of Jesus, Jesus himself. AD 31 is the foundational. And because of AD 31, we can speak about 1844. But if you dissect 1844 from 31, then all heresies are there. So let me stress it. The year AD 31 and not 1844 has to be the foundational and beginning reference point of God's eschatological judgment. And let me stress, there is no dichotomy, not diversive or discrepancy between AD 31 and AD 1844. You do not need to choose between them. They need to be put together in the proper relationship and perspective, and always with the starting point of 31. You know what was the problem of Desmond Ford? Everybody heard the name Desmond Ford, probably. And you know that he rejected the biblical and Adventist teaching about pre-advent judgment. Why? Because he could not put these two dates together. He said, well, I love Jesus, AD 31, he died for me. I don't need 1844. And because he could not put these two together. So he was preaching and he was saying, what do you want? Do you want Jesus? Or you want some kind of this esoteric judgment which going on in heaven? What do you want? And people, of course, were responding, we want Jesus, Jesus, this is the most important. But my presentation is not giving you that impression, false impression, that you have to choose 31 or 1844. No, both are biblical teaching, but you need to do it from the right perspective and from the right beginning. You cannot start with 1844, but you have to start with AD 31, always with Christ, always with the cross of Jesus. It is a better way to preach about God's judgment. What is the better way? Well, the better way is really to focus on Jesus, to focus on the cross of Jesus. The cross is and must be the central event for all our doctrines. Amen? Do you believe that like that? I strongly believe this. Please never, never, never dissect cross from the judgment. Never present judgment without Jesus Christ, without his death for us at Calvary. You know, this is a very serious matter for me, so I will say it in this way. To preach or teach about God's judgment and start with 1844 is what? Grievous sin. It's not only a light sin, it's a grievous sin. This is very, very serious. Neglect to put Christ at the center results in a religious crime. Because people then live in a spiritual schizophrenia. You know, it's a psychological problem. And you have either cross or 1844. No, we need to have both together. But both together from the right perspective. When you don't start with 1844, but you start with Jesus, with the cross of Jesus. And this event will give you enough material and enough light that you can enter to the understanding what's going on in 1844. Let me give you here one example. Probably some of you heard the name Dale Radcliff. He wrote a book, several books. He was our pastor, Seventh Adventist pastor in North America, but he is now out of our church. He has a big group, and his main point is fighting against Seventh Adventist Church. And he's speaking about that Sabbath is wrong, and doctrine of the sanctuary is wrong, and what we are doing is completely unbiblical, and so forth. And what was the starting point? For him, the starting point was misunderstanding of really biblical teaching, the real understanding of the doctrine of the sanctuary. Because he understood that, doctrine of the sanctuary is all about 1844, it's all about judgment, and it's robbed him this beauty and assurance of salvation. This is why, like one of you told me right in the break, this issue about judgment is so scary that I rather not speak about judgment. I rather speak only about the cross of Jesus. and people today are avoiding, even pastors are avoiding to speak about judgment because this is like two different things. Well, one thing is about 1844 and one thing is about the cross. And you can see that we need to put things together from the right perspective. Let me say it in this way. Some evangelists or pastors think that if they know how to prove mathematically, arithmetically 1844, you put 457 BC and then you go to the 70 weeks of prophecy and then you draw the chart. And when you are able to present the year 1844 mathematically, arithmetically, and when you are able to explain the symbolism of the furniture in the tabernacle, then they think that they know the doctrine of the sanctuary. How tragic. But the date of 1844 and the sanctuary furniture are only what? A framework of the picture. Framework, a picture frame, but the picture is still missing. So when you will prove to me the year 1844, I will say, all right, but so what? You just started your lecture. So, all right, you explain 1844, this is important date. That's fine, this is mathematics. But so what? What is the picture? The framework you have here, but you did not present, you did not paint anything yet. You did not tell me what is the picture, what is going on with 1844. And this is our problem. We speak about furniture, about esoteric things, and we speak about mathematics, and when we finish this, we think, oh, we did everything right. No, you just started. You make some maybe good introduction, maybe confusing introduction for many, but you just started. The picture is not yet there. And this is what we need to do much better. The picture frame is essential and significant. The picture frame is very significant because it provides a specific background and gives flavor to the picture. You can have, nice picture. If you go with the wrong frame, the picture will be distorted. And you can have a very beautiful frame, but if you don't have the right picture there, it's also distorted. Framework is very important, but the most important is the picture itself. And God is giving us in scriptures both beautiful frame, but also a magnificent picture. And more I study that picture, more I am in awe before God, and more I am in love with my God. So we need to help people to see Jesus at the center of this biblical teaching. So let me also tell you that several years ago I preached in Sydney, the place where Desmond Ford was also preaching, and people were very confused. And I was preaching about pre-advent judgment from the perspective of the cross. And I put Jesus at the center. And then when I finished, two pastors came to me. And they were, very serious, very talkative. And if I summarize what they said to me, they said the following. If the message you presented tonight was preached in Australia 30 years ago, and today we will say even more than 30 years ago, there will be no Desmond Ford crisis. This is the problem. We, can be guilty sometimes to dissect cross and the pre-advent judgment. And this, as I said, this is a religious crime. We need to do better job. So what is the better job? Well, better job is to, as I stated from the biblical perspective, to start eschatology not from 1844, but as the Bible is teaching us, from the cross of Jesus. Let me put it very strongly here in that picture. You can understand. John in Revelation chapter 13 is telling us that the Lamb, Jesus Christ, was slain. Jesus Christ died. How many years ago? 2,000 years ago? What he's saying there? This is not only historical truth, but it is now theological truth. 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ really died on the cross, historically, factually. But theologically, when he died, John is saying the Lamb was slain from the foundation or from the creation of the world. It means that the whole history of sin and the whole history of what is going on this planet Earth is done from the perspective of the cross. And this is what we have here. The Lamb was slain from the foundation of the world, from the creation of the world. So we need to really put Christ at the center, and the cross of Jesus need to be the central of all our doctrines. Well, I prove it so far from the Bible. Let me now show you two very important statements from Ellen G. White, and I love these statements, and I wish that you memorize these statements I will show you now by memory. The first one, Gospel Workers, page 315. The sacrifice of Jesus as an atonement for sin, this is cross, right? So the sacrifice of Christ as an atonement for sin is the great truth around which all other truths cluster. It's like you are in the lake and you take a pebble and you throw it into the water. Then this will be the main point, and then you will see the circles going bigger, 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 bigger. This is this cluster on which everything else need to be hanging. So the cross of Jesus is the great truth around which all other truths cluster. In order to be rightly understood and appreciated, the cross of Jesus, every truth, how many? Every truth in the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation must be studied in the light that streams from the cross of Calvary. So when you preach about judgment, it must be streaming from the cross of Jesus. Whatever you do pre-advent judgment, you do judgment, whatever topic, or from repentance to salvation and to new eternal life, it's all related to the cross of Jesus. And then she continues, I present before you the great grand monument, which is the cross of mercy and regeneration, salvation and redemption. The Son of God uplifted on the cross. This is to be the foundation of every discourse given by our ministers. Whatever you preach, whatever you teach, whatever you explain to people, everything must be always centered on the cross. So when you speak about God's judgment, you have no other choice. It's biblical, it's confirmed by the Ellen G. White. You cannot speak about eschatological time and starting with 1844. If you would do that, you would sin, as I said. But if you start with the cross, then you will bring people to Jesus and you will build the picture more and more. So here is the other text, Gospel Workers, the same book, now page 156. What Ellen G. White is saying, of all professing Christians, and you know how many denominations we have, a Seventh-day Adventist should be foremost, the first in uplifting Christ before the world. How people in Philippines know you as Seventh-day Adventist? By what? When they hear Seventh-day Adventist, what they will say? Oh, there are these people who don't drink coffee, right? Oh, I know, there are these people who are vegetarian, some of them. Oh, these people, they are keeping Sabbath. You see how we are missing the point? People are knowing us by something else than what they should know. They should know us that we are in love with Jesus, and that when we all, what we are explaining in our beautiful doctrines, that we all relate to Jesus. You know, when people are asking you, why are you keeping Sabbath? Why not to simply answer, you know, I love Jesus, and Jesus kept the Sabbath. This is why I follow his example. I keep the Sabbath. You know that in the Bible, in the Gospel, it stated that he is the Lord even of the Sabbath. Yes, he is the Lord of the Sabbath. So I uplift this Lord of the Sabbath. Bring this not, well, the Ten Commandments are saying that we have to keep the Sabbath. Bring it to that later, but bring it from the perspective of the cross. Bring it from the perspective of Jesus Christ. When they will asking you why you don't eat pork, don't say, well, you know, in Leviticus you have these statements, and Moses gave this, God revealed to him. Too complicated. They will already know, oh, he's trying to explain things in very difficult way. But you can say very simply, you know, Jesus Christ is the model of my life. He's example of everything. And do you know that Jesus never ate pork? And this is why I am not eating pork. You see the entry point? You don't need to explain many difficult things, because they are actually even not interested in your explanations. They are interesting maybe to tease you. So bring the answer and point to Jesus, that you are in love with Jesus. Then we will be known as people who are uplifting Christ. We will be known as people who, from all professed Christians, you know, are the foremost who point to Jesus. You know, sometimes our forefathers and we also were guilty that we thought, well, the others are preaching Christ, so we need to preach the law. Wrong, very wrong. If they are preaching Christ, let's rejoice. This is good news if they are preaching Christ, but let's help them to preach this Christ in more totality, with a bigger picture, better understanding. Help them to understand the biblical truth better. Not to criticize, but to join and to bring it even greater. And this is our mission. So this is what I am actually doing, and will in the next hour, when we will be starting our discussions again, I will go not to three phases of God's eschatological judgment. I will go to how many? I will go to seven phases of divine universal judgment. You know, God's judgment, that universal judgment presented in the Bible from the first pages of the Bible to the last pages, this God's judgment is presented in seven phases, not in three phases as we usually are telling. We are usually saying what? It started in 1844 with pre-advent judgment, then we go to time of millennium, judgment during millennium, and then we go to last judgment at the end of millennium. This is biblical, but it is not enough. This is misleading, and this is the problem. We are presenting a partial truth, and when we are presenting partial truth and dissecting it from the most important event, the cross, no wonder then people are afraid of judgment. They don't want to speak about judgment. They don't want to hear about judgment. And they are even, some of them, rejecting that teaching as specific Adventist, and this is nothing to do with the Bible. But if we will do it rightly and correctly, then they will see that everything in the judgment of God is centered on the cross. I could not make it like in the center here, because then you will have like the first part very empty and then plenty of things here. But I could do that graphically, you know. But imagine that this cross of Jesus is really at the center of the whole panorama I am presenting here. The God's judgment is nothing else than a celebration of the cross of Jesus. You hear correctly. When we speak about God's judgment, it's a celebration of God's judgment, because God's judgment is nothing else than the plan of salvation. God's judgment is a plan of salvation, not in three, but in seven phases. And all phases are centered on the cross. Each phase is celebrating the results and effectiveness of the cross of Jesus. This is this beautiful, beautiful teaching. Well, let me tell you that what I am presenting to you, you can find on this website, www.atsjats.org. This is a website of Adventist Theological Society. And Adventist Theological Society is publishing a journal of Adventist Theological Society. And all the past issues of this journal you can find in this website. It is for free. You don't need to pay any fee. And you will have the best articles from, I don't know, more than 17 volumes of this journal. And you will have the best of our scholarship in that website. You will have different articles on creation, repentance, or New Earth, or Ezekiel, Daniel, eschatology, and you can name the topic. But also, you can find my two articles I wrote about the judgment of God. You will have the article about this seven phases of God's judgment, when you have the celebration of the cross. And then you will have another article, which I presented in my first presentation today, but with much more details and things which you need to understand. And this is the article also on the website, Judgment as Salvation. So I would strongly recommend to you that you will go to that website. You will click on the archives. You will have many other things there. You will have podcasting. You can listen to some presentations. You will have some articles from the more popular, for popular audience, the digest, of some articles. It is there. But then you will have this Journal of Adventist Theological Society. Then you click on it. it will give you another screen, and you can search now for different articles by topics or by names. And you can click on my name, for example, and then all articles I wrote for this journal will appear. And then you can find these two articles on judgment, and this will give you this beautiful understanding. So I think that here I can stop, and we can have some more discussion, and then a good break for a few more minutes. And I would like to repeat once again, when you speak about God's eschatological judgment, never, never, never start with 1844. This is a specific eschatological time. But eschatological time started with the first coming of Jesus, was inaugurated by the cross of Jesus. And when from that perspective you will present things, so people will suddenly see that Jesus is really at the center of everything. So this was maybe more technical, but very important insight to our panorama of God judgment, which we will now start in the next hour. And so next 2 hours will show you how in practical way you can put cross and judgment together. Gospel and eschatology goes hand to hand. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, when we open your scriptures and we see you who is the center of scriptures, so we are in awe. And more we know you, more we want to follow you, more we are in love with you. So please help us to understand your scriptures. Help us to be more diligent, that we can see you everywhere, that we can see that beautiful picture, who you are, that we as Seventh-day Adventists, we can preach about your character, about your beauty, and be the first among all other Christians to present you, uplift you, that people will be attracted to you and want to follow you because you are so good. So thank you for being with us, and help us really to grasp better this biblical teaching, your teaching about judgment, that you will be always uplifted in our hearts, in our mind, and through us also among other people. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for teaching us. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Okay, so once again, we would like to thank Dr. Moskala for a very enlightening presentation. So shall we give him a round of applause for that presentation? Thank you so much, Doctor. Because of time limitation, according to the time controller, so we only have 10 minutes, you know? And we would like to adhere with our policy and guidelines that we would entertain questions that are only relevant and related to our topic. So there are questions in my hand, but there are some that probably we should reserve to other time, not today, okay? So, Dr. Moskala, there are 2 questions here, and probably if we still have time, we would entertain 1 or 2 after these 2 questions. The first question is that, when Jesus said in the book of Matthew 28, maybe this one is verse 19 or 20, that I am with you always to the end of the age, the word end of the age, which time was Jesus referring to? Is that the end of the ages as was discussed a while
ago?
Yes,
every phraseology which we have in the Bible need to be understood in the context. You know that when you study the Bible, context, and context is decisive for the meaning. In that particular verse, Jesus is now referring that he will be with us from the time when he came on this earth, and even though he will be not here physically, he will be still with us till the very end. And this very end is the second coming of Jesus. So it's like he's pointing from my first coming to my second coming. I will be always with you. I will never abandon you. And of course, he will be not physically with us, but he will be with his Holy Spirit, through Holy Spirit and through his word with us always.
Okay, thank you, Doctor. So we have another question here. The Lamb of God that was slain from the creation seems to point to Jesus' death, of course, on the cross. Does it mean that the end of ages started after the fall of man? It means that, theologically speaking, the end of the ages started after the fall because of the passage.
No, there is no statement in the Bible that eschatological time would be here from the fall of humanity into sin. This is a very tragic event which marks a total reverse of creation. The fall of humanity is like decreation. And then in that decreation, in Genesis chapter 3, you have God who is coming as a judge, and he is starting a recreation, okay? And this is in the view of especially verse 15 in chapter 3, when he's speaking that what humanity and humans will be never be able to accomplish for themselves, the promised seed will come and do. And this promised seed will defeat our arch enemy, Satan, and will establish a new plan, will establish salvation. So it's Genesis chapter 3 is not beginning of eschatological time. It's a beginning of God's promise of salvation. The plan of salvation starts from that point, and it is only because the original plan of God was distorted by sin. So from creation to decreation to recreation, partially by faith, and then to the full recreation at the time of the second Jesus coming and third coming after millennium.
So maybe within a couple of minutes we have two more questions. The first one is that a recent speaker at the GYC convention argued that the sanctuary was the hermeneutical key to biblical theology, scripture, and the gospel. Do you agree with that one?
Yes, I fully agree. We as Seventh-day Adventists, we have a great advantage grasping the beauty of the biblical understanding, biblical teaching, and we can in that way bring a very good contribution to the Christianity, that they can really understand better. And for our theology, what is very crucial are, two or three things which are at the bottom of everything. This is the first one is the understanding of the great controversy. This is the framework in which everything what we are doing is understood. You cannot understand Adventist theology without this framework. This is why some theologians outside, but also some people inside, when they see that and they want to teach something else, one thing they have to put down is the understanding of that meta-narrative of the Bible, this great controversy. In outside of Adventists, they speak about spiritual warfare, which is different terminology for the same. Spiritual warfare, war between good and evil, great controversy. And this is something we can bring as a contribution to non-Adventist theologians. And the second one is if we correctly present the doctrine of the sanctuary. Doctrine of the sanctuary, at the core of the doctrine is the message about judgment, and we are now discovering how beautiful it is. You can really enjoy it. You can feel good about the teaching about God's judgment. This is where we can also bring very important contribution to it. And of course, our third very important emphasis in our theology is creation. If you don't believe in the biblical creation, and I now mean not only to prove again evolution is wrong and creation is wrong, but the theology of creation. So you will see how that theology of creation is actually permeating every doctrine of the Bible. all our 28 fundamental beliefs are standing or falling on our right understanding of the creation theology. And this is very important. So with these three emphases, I would say, we can really bring this eternal gospel in at home, even in today's Christian world and non-Christian world. They need to hear that this plan of salvation, which is centered on the cross, the doctrine of the sanctuary, which is again nothing else than the plan of salvation in the visible way, how it works, and with the stress on God, who He is, that He is our Creator, also our Savior, and He's our Recreator. This is the theme without which we cannot understand the Scriptures and be really faithful Seventh-day Adventist.
Okay, so given that we don't have time anymore, maybe let me just read this very quickly. This is a clarification only.
Okay.
And the remaining questions, probably I'm going to give this back to our coordinator, so that if this afternoon we still have time, probably we will try to answer. But we will be focusing on this one. It's a clarification. Did the eschatological judgment begin before the crucifixion, or after His birth, or after He was crucified? So,
no, I would say that, you know, the whole life of Jesus on this planet Earth is centered on the cross. He was born in order to die. He lived in order to die. Everything what He was doing, it was done in view of His cross. Of course, His life is very important, because this life is showing us who is God. It's a revelation of God, His character of God, and also it's clearly showing how we, as His followers, need to live. So life is important, but all what is in His life is in view of the cross. And then, because of the cross because of His victorious death, He was resurrected by the Father. So you see that what is going before or after the cross is all centered at the cross. This is why for Paul was very clear. What I am preaching, I am decided not to preach nothing else than the cross of Jesus. So in other words, cross is a symbol for everything which is related and which is the center point. And the center point is really that Jesus Christ is our Savior. Cross is not piece of wood. Cross is person, is Jesus Christ.
Okay, so with this, we are going to have our, how many minutes of break? It's about 5 minutes, okay? So as we have our break, so that we would be prepared for the next presentation, we would like to request everyone to spend your break doing your things that you need to do, but we would like to give our speaker a time of rest. So if it is possible that you would reserve your question, probably in some other time, but not during the break, so that our speaker will have some minutes of rest in preparation for the next presentation. Okay, so we will be having our break for 5 minutes and then come back so that we can start our next session. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you.